Yeah, yeah, that's the story, no? Income is a measure of well-being and growth is a measure of progress. So that's what that is the dominant thinking. That's why people keep pushing for higher growth, higher growth, higher growth, because that shows societies are progressing. So people have questioned whether GDP can be any per capita income or GDP measure can be a good measure of well-being. There are a lot of measurement issues which I think are important to use. So it is the market value of goods and services. So a lot of non-market activities don't get counted in it. And so one of the biggest critiques of GDP as a measure of well-being comes from feminist economics, because a lot of women's work in the household is unpaid work. And so the allegation is that if you're doing housework which is not paid or helping in the house, that doesn't consider as market activities. So the joke in all the economics textbook is that if you hire a cook and she's cooking for you, you're paying her. But if you marry the cook, then the GDP will go because it becomes a non-market activity. So nothing has changed, but that's it. Market prices may not reflect the true value of goods and services. So if you take this bottle of water, it's say let's 20 rupees. Is that really the real value of water? In fact, many of these companies that are selling us bottled water are not paying for the water. They just extract it from the underground. So questions are asked that if you see something like this is 20 rupees, does it really capture the real value of the product? Like the quote also said, it includes production of goods and bads as well. Environmental consequences are ignored, so the environmentalists have launched a very scathing attack on GDP as a measure of well-being. And others have also talked about moral and ethical appeal of GDP. In fact, a good example would be if you say that a revolver is valued 10,000 times more than a loaf of bread or a liter of milk, what kind of a measure of well-being is that? Because you're using all these guns and revolvers to shoot people and kill people. But then the GDP, if you keep manufacturing small arms, that's really contributing to the GDP. By the way, most of the arms that go into the hands of terrorists today are small arms. And these are manufactured by these four or five members of the Security Council. And so that is the real source of the problem. And nowhere in any of these discussions does it come out saying, let these members of the Security Council stop manufacturing small arms and then problems will solve. At the same time, there's also another thing, that higher incomes may not capture all aspects of life and well-being and not everything that we cherish. So to give you an example, we saw Delhi is now the state with the highest per capita income. But Delhi is notorious for the safety of girls and women and for air pollution. And that's the story of many cities, capital cities, that the capital cities tend to become among the richest in the country, but they're also plagued by a lot of crime, a lot of pollution, a lot of traffic congestion, and so on and so forth. So higher incomes or per capita incomes do not necessarily capture what we want ideal societies to be. The second problem is that there are a lot of gaps between the conversion of income into well-being. And especially in the Indian context, it is mediated by gender, caste, class, etc. So, to give you an example, suppose a woman is married to a very rich landlord in Rajasthan, and he's in some rural village owning, let's say, 5,000 acres of land. So she's very rich in that sense, but what use is that wealth if she cannot go out of the house to meet anybody, or if she can't invite friends over? So there's a complete curtailment of her freedoms to do what she wants to do. So that wealth really doesn't matter. Or similarly, in that same village, of what use is this enormous 5,000 acres of land you own if there is no good school for the child, or if there is no primary health care center or hospital care facility or something? So in the second case, the conversion of income into well-being is mediated by the public provisioning of goods and services by the state. In the first case, it was a gender issue because women couldn't step out of the house. So similarly with caste and religion and so on. So the fundamental point is that more wealth does not automatically convert into well-being.